me in prayer. Lord, I thank you as many today are reflecting on their fathers, and we thank you, Lord, that regardless of how that's turned out or turning out, that we can always go to you. And like Pastor Tom was sharing, Dad, like, you don't renege on your word. You are true. You are faithful. You show us. You lead us. You guide us. You love us. You care for us. You provide for us. There's not enough words to describe it, Dad, but we are grateful today as we celebrate our earthly fathers, and we come to you today to celebrate the one and only Father, the great I Am. We thank you, Lord. We ask for your blessings over all of us here, those that can't be here today. We thank you for blessing this city with this nation, Father. We thank you, Lord, as you're coming back for the apple of your eye, the children of Jerusalem, Father God. We pray for the peace of Jerusalem. We thank you, Lord, as Gentiles, to have the opportunity to be grafted into your family. We thank you for that opportunity through what your Son, Jesus Christ, did, Lord. And Dad, we come to you saying all these things and oh so many more things that are not spoken right now, but we come to you in your Son, Jesus Christ's mighty name. Amen. Now, Father's Day, I've talked about this story a few times. I haven't in a few years, but it's a very popular story, and that it's pertinent to Father's Day. It's the parable of the prodigal son. And it's a very familiar story, and it's a story of a domestic struggle of a father and his two boys. And the point Jesus is making in telling this story, this parable, it's really straightforward. It's not that complicated. Our relationship with God the Father is like the relationships of these two sons with their earthly father. And the fact is, right now, if you haven't already, I think each of us is thinking about our earthly fathers. Some of us, that's just a great, joyous occasion. Others, it's not so great. It actually could be very painful. And it could be churning some things in us right now, but we need to hear this parable. We need to hear this story that Jesus shares. So please listen. And in this story, Jesus is doing at least two things. He's probably doing a lot more, but I can pretty much tell you he's at least doing two things. One is that Jesus is extending a welcome to all of us who will admit their sinful condition. And two, the second one, is Jesus is issuing a warning to those whose rebellion against God is disguised by a smug self-righteousness. So let's read this parable. Let's read this story, starting with Luke chapter 15, verse 11. And Jesus had been speaking here, so let's pick it up. There was a man who had two sons. The younger one said to his father, "Father, give me my share of the estate." So he divided his property between them. Not long after that, the younger son got together all he had, set off for a distant country, and there squandered his wealth in wild living. After he had spent everything, there was a severe famine in that whole country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to a citizen of that country who sent him to his fields to feed pigs. He longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating, but no one gave him anything. When he came to his senses, he said, "How many of my father's hired servants have food to spare, and here I am starving to death? I will set out and go back to my father and say to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants.' So he got up and went to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him. The son said to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to his servants, 'Quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fattened calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. So they began to celebrate. Meanwhile, the older son was in the field. When he came near the house, he heard music and dancing. So he called one of the servants and asked him what was going on. "Your brother has come," he replied, "and your father has killed the fattened calf, and because he was back safe and sound." The older brother became angry and refused to go in. So his father went out and pleaded with him. But he answered his father, "Look, all these years I've been slaving for you and never disobeyed your orders. Yet you never gave me even a young goat so I could celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours, who has squandered your property with prostitutes, comes home, you killed a fattened calf for him." "My son," the father said, "you are always with me, and everything I have is yours. But we had to celebrate and be glad, because this brother of yours was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found." Amen. Now, there's a lot in here to talk about, but I want to begin by drawing our attention to verse 20. Jesus says, "He got up and went to his father." Now, this is again about the boy. He, after admitting he's messed up, he's screwed up, and he's like, "I need to return to dad." But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him. That's kind of where I want to start. And I want to look at this verse here, and if you will, let's kind of try to draw a picture, to get a visual of what's going on here. And as we begin this verse 20, we've got to have a view of the son. We've got to paint a picture of this boy. The words say, Jesus said he's a long way off. Now this is this young lad who had left home, and he's on his way back home now. Now let's take a good look at him. We should notice some things. The word of God says that he's shoeless. He's got no shoes. He's in rags. He's emaciated. He hasn't eaten. Okay? And he's humiliated. That's the picture we need to have of this young man. All right? And we're told explicitly here that the father saw him. Long way off. He saw him. And so what seems to be implicit in this story is that the reason the father saw him is because the father never stopped watching for him. Now, I don't think I'm reading too much into this if we say that what we have here in this picture is a waiting father. All right? In other words, there never was a day when the father didn't wonder about this young son. Long days, for sure, stretching into weeks, and the weeks stretching into months, wondering about this young son. And with each passing day, the likelihood of the son returning, I know, it kind of gets less and less. I mean, another day passes, another week passes, another month. Where's my boy? Right? And it's probably that type of thing of a waiting father, you know, that his friends, his neighbors, are kind of telling him, hey, just give up, man. It's hopeless. He's gone. He's gone for good. Friends and neighbors wondering about what the dad's always looking for. They always see him out there, and he seems to be pondering a little bit, maybe a little daydreaming, looking in the distance. For instance, if they're gathering at, like today's vernacular, the grocery store, folks would be saying, "Well, what is he waiting for?" And then another neighbor joins in. You know how that happens, how we do that. We hear people talking about somebody's situation, and somebody else will come in and go, "Man, I don't know why he cares about that ungrateful good-for-nothing boy. He's gone forever. Why does he keep waiting for him and watching for him?" But dad's always out there, always watching, always waiting. So that's kind of the scene here, and a little background of this dad. So this picture, let's go to the next scene of this picture. And after spotting this young son, we now see the dad is running to his son and I don't know about you, but some of you older guys around here, frankly, that's not the most dignified thing us older guys can do. Right? You don't see many older men running, do we? And if you doubt that, Dad, your pride's rising up a little bit right now. Just think about how you look when you're running and how the people laugh at us. Right? And in this context, back in this picture, okay, back all these thousands of years ago, these guys wore long flowing robes, which kind of impeded progress. They didn't have blue jeans. They didn't have pants. They had robes. Okay? So when they wanted to make good time, if they wanted to run, they had to like hitch up their robes, put it in their belt, cinch it up here. But then when that's going on, you know what would be exposed? Their legs and their sandals. Okay? But Jesus said, this is what's going on in this time. So this guy, this father, ran to them looking like that. Given the glimpse of his son, he goes running down the street, filled with compassion, and his heart is overflowing as his arms are reaching out, to this son. He doesn't come up to his son and, hey, nice to see you again, son. How you been? Doesn't shake hands. No, the father's arms are all over this boy, saying, come here, son, and he's smothering him. He's pulling him in with hugs and kisses. And remember now, remember the son. Remember that scene, the picture of the son. This son's smelly. He doesn't look very sharp. He's tagged in just rags, right? But Dad doesn't care one bit as he draws him in and he's hugging and kissing him. And that, if that's not all there is, I mean, look at this in verse 24. He says, the dad says, for this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. So they began to celebrate. Not only was Dad waiting and watching, but now Dad, we have the picture of a dad running, loving, kissing, and then Dad is also dancing. I mean, what a scene. Just now, think about your own lives. Think about your own families. If there's ever a time when if a dad comes into a scene and he's laughing and joking and singing and praising and hugging and kissing and dancing, it'll change the entire environment. It'll change the entire environment of that family, man. Now, the flip side works just as well. Oh, do I know that oh so well. If you come in like a bull in the china shop, Dad, and I've done that so many times, everybody's scared. Whoa, what's going on? Get away from him. He's not happy. Do I have your attention? Yeah. You smelling what I'm cooking? All right. See, either way, a father doing that will impact the entire event. So that's how I think this picture would look like of this young son and father encounter. Now, put that picture aside, if you will, and let's dig into this story in a different way. For instance, I was pondering this, and, you know, why does Jesus even tell this story? That's the kind of thing we need. What's the significance of this story? Why do we need to read and hear about this story? And does it even matter? These are the type of things I want to look at. Like many of you, I've read this story multiple times. I've heard sermons on it multiple times. I've given some sermons on this. This time as I'm reading this, this question kind of came to me and it never had before. Is there something wrong with the picture I just shared? That's what I'm at. Is there something wrong with this picture? I mean, there's so much right in this picture. Why would anyone even ask what's wrong with the picture? Right? But honestly, there is really something wrong in this picture. Let me explain. This younger son does not get what he deserves. Right? Does this young man deserve this type of treatment? Think about what the boy's done in today's terms, if you will. He took the car, he took all his clothes, he took the money, and he headed out to Vegas. You know, he just went somewhere, just get crazy, right? And then what happens? He totals the car, right? He spends all the money, then he kind of pawns all of his clothes to get more money, and now he's penniless. Okay? All the while he's doing this, he's acting like a complete fool. He's trashing your name because he's got your name. Okay? He's got the family name. And then he comes walking back home with his tail between his legs, right? Right? And his father has a party. Ha! What type of father is this? This boy had forfeited every single thing about his father's goodness. Even if nobody else understood that, this boy sure understood it. Think about yourself now. So how are we supposed to understand what's going on here? Well, the only way to understand this is to remember that Jesus is telling this story about his father. In the natural, if you're having a hard time with this, I'm not surprised. Because it's not about you, it's about how you're supposed to do it based on how dad does it. Okay? Right? In other words, God's ways are not our ways. Thank you, Lord. Right? The love of God, the concern of God for the lost is the story that Jesus is telling us. Jesus is telling us that God actually loves saving people. Right? Now, remember now, when you're hearing the word love, God's type of love is sacrificial love. So God actually very much enjoys sacrificing to save someone. God very much enjoys forgiving sins. And both of these sons in this story depict our condition. We've only talked about the younger son. We're going to get to the older son. Hang in there. Right? And, which means we're all separated from God by either willful rebellion or passive indifference. We are the ones who are separated from the Father. We are the ones with a broken relationship. And the Father in this story is depicting our Heavenly Father, the Great I Am. Now let's just stop and think about that for a moment to grasp just how amazing this really is. And remember that Jesus is speaking largely to a Jewish audience. He begins this discourse talking about lost things. Luke chapter 15, he starts with a lost sheep. Then he parlays that right into a lost coin, and he's finishing now with a lost son, right? And in addition, this mainly Jewish audience would have heard over and over about how God spoke to them from Mount Sinai with thunder and lightning and fire. And Jesus is teaching them and giving them a picture of his father and their spiritual father as this type of father. This is the type of father Jesus is wanting us to understand. He's a waiting father. He's a watching father. He's a running, loving, hugging, kissing, dancing, and forgiving father. Now, another question I asked that I hadn't really asked before after reading this all these years is, who's missing from this story? No. Jesus. Jesus is telling this story, but Jesus is essential to this story because the one who is telling the story is the key ingredient to the way the story unfolds. Let me show it to you this way. Some people have told this story like this. They say, God is a great loving father. All of us as his sons and daughters have wandered off and made a huge mess of things, but God doesn't really care about the mess we made. In fact, God cares so little about that, he has decided to have a party, and you're welcome at the party. Therefore, do not worry about what you did. In other words, God winks at sin, and God doesn't care about sin. Mess up all you like and do whatever you want over and over and come on back every time because it's fine. Now, what would be wrong about coming to that conclusion? Because right now I know I got a lot of you going, what is he talking about? I mean, because on face value, that is kind of what it looks like is being said here in this very story. But if you're not paying attention, you will miss the key component. When Jesus is telling this story and he says, when the Father saw him and was moved with compassion for the Son. At that point, we all have to understand and put through the filter that Jesus himself, in telling this story and emphasizing compassion this father is showing, is the very fact that Jesus is telling the story. Meaning Jesus is there telling this story on the account of his father's love and compassion, who gave his one and only begotten son because the father so loved the world. John 3:16. Right? For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. So Jesus is speaking this story of the father's love, and we have some real trouble understanding the compassion of God unless, folks, and big unless here, we see it through the lens of the cross of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Right? And furthermore, let me tell you why. God is good, and God forgets. God is just, and therefore God punishes sin. So an obvious question is, how then can God simultaneously display justice while punishing, right, and punishing, and also mercy when he pardons us? In this story, folks, if God is simply not winking at sin and simply not letting the young son off, then how in the world is justice being served? The answer is in what Jesus did on the cross, folks. If we struggle with understanding God as a loving father, it's because we have yet to grasp the revelation of Jesus Christ on the cross. If you still struggle with understanding the compassion of God, it's because you haven't fully said to yourself, "Here I am, Lord, lost and alone in this big world, and God, thank you for sending your son to me." That's the answer for what's going on. God's love here is expressed in this story, but this story doesn't contain all that is necessary to understand God's love. We need to, like, if you will, take a step back from this story and look at the bigger picture, and then realize that God's compassion is conveyed at the cross of Jesus Christ. Folks, it's at the cross that Lord Jesus, who was sinless and perfect, took all of our sin upon himself. Jesus became sin on the cross. That's where the justice of God took place. That's why the Father can be compassionate if you've received the Son. See, every single one of us have forfeited our rights to our Father's love. Every right to a party, every right to a warm embrace and a warm welcome. But after what we have done, we still could, to this day, to this day, be embraced, be welcomed and loved because of what Jesus Christ has done. So what is our part? Our part is to confess. Daniel started it off beautifully today. He said, hey, let's acknowledge our Father today by confessing. You want to know what every father in this room wants from their kids? They might not realize it, but you'll agree with me. Every time my kids tell, Dad, what do you want? I don't want anything. All I want is for you to obey me. I'm serious. That's all God wants. He wants you to obey him. If you don't obey him, he wants you to confess it. That's all he wants. He says, you confess it, I'm running to you. You're confessing it, I'm running to you. Remember, the boy said to dad, hey, I mean, he's like, man, we're throwing a party. You don't have to say anymore. I'm loving on you. He's confessing. That's what every earthly father wants, and that's what our heavenly father wants, is for our obedience, right? See, you got to ask yourself, have you ever confessed to God? See, to the fathers here today, those watching online, talking to the dads now, have you ever really faced up to whether you have a relationship with God the Father or not? You got to ask yourself, have you? This is not a question about your interest in church and appearing like you and your family have it all together, or even the concern or the well-being of your family, or issues of freedom, or even religious doctrine. No, that's not what it's about. It's something far more significant than that, gentlemen. Have you ever come to your senses just like this young son did? Have you ever taken a good, hard look at things just like this boy did? Most of us are not prepared to take a good, hard look at things, and especially take a good, hard, long look at ourselves. Because if we are prepared to take a good, hard look at ourselves, we may come to the same conclusion that this boy came to, and that's very demeaning. It will humble us. And reality is, there are still those that are unprepared to do that, because we may have to admit that deep down inside we're falling apart. We don't know where we're going, and we can't make any sense of our journey, and our lives have taken it all in. Oh, we'll fill in the blanks in a variety of ways, but if we take a good, hard, long look at ourselves, we realize that while it might not be a pigsty which we find ourselves in, things are not the way we think they would or should be at this point. And in that moment, right there, of self-realization, there is an opportunity, folks, for transformation to take a hold, for you to renew your mind and transform into the very likeness of God. Now, some of us will go around that mountain right there routinely, and we will keep saying to ourselves, I am going to deal with this one of these days. I will face up to that, and I will tackle that issue one of these days. Well, there's a problem with that, because if that describes you, then you are presuming on the patience of God. So if we come to that very moment and face up to things and are unprepared to do what is necessary, meaning to confess, here's what we likely do. We put on a mask. And if we could, we would mask the reality from ourselves and from God. But you know what? We can't. We can't hide our own heart from God, and we can't hide our own hearts from ourselves. You can't. But it doesn't prevent us from hiding it from other people. The fact is, so many of us don't know who we are. In fact, many of us don't know who we want to be. And furthermore, many of us don't know who we're supposed to be. And guess what? Your mask is slipping. Right? And you know, and God knows. Don't you think on this day we celebrate fathers, dads, it would make a lot of sense to listen to your own advice that you've told your children and take a good hard look at yourself and admit what the young son admitted, that you're lost? This young son's real need wasn't for something called food, but his real need was for a relationship with someone called father. That those insatiable longings from the world would never satisfy him. How he looked on the outside was indicative of how his spiritual inside was empty. Meaning this young man was lost and this young man was guilty. And many of us are just as lost and just as guilty. That's why Jesus is telling us this story. That's why we need to hear this story again. And just like this son, our folly is rooted in our stubborn desire to go it alone, to live without God, to give God the finger at his rules. And just like the son, we have sinned against heaven in God's sight. And just like this young son, we need not only the father's friendship, but we need the father's forgiveness. And it's remarkable that once this boy comes to his senses and prepares his speech, because the boy had forfeited every right to a place in the father's house, because he knows the best he can hope for is to be a hired helper and live in the worker's tent. So what does this young boy meet? His confession is met with compassion. Right? Folks, there is nothing that will make us realize so clearly the sinfulness of our sin and the other, you know, just unworthiness of our personal awakening of the love of God, our Father, welcoming us in our rebellion and our lostness. It's God's love for us. This prodigal son went back home not primarily because he was tormented by a guilty conscience, but because he was driven by the hope of mercy. That's why so many of us are here right now in churches across this land. We're hoping for mercy from God because of the knucklehead things we've just done. That's why we're here. Right? And you know what? This young son wasn't disappointed, and you won't be disappointed either if you confess it. Right? I mean, look at how this plays out. Confession, compassion, celebration. Hallelujah. Right? Talk about a great deal. But let's not gloss over who missed the revelation of this celebration. The older son was in the field, and when he came near the house, he heard the music and dancing. And what kept him out of the celebration? The very same thing that keeps some of us out of the celebration. It's pride masked in self-righteousness. The elder son who had remained by his father's side all this time, while this younger son was gone, comes in from the field and is ticked off and says, "What the heck is going on here?" And the servant says, "Hey man, this is great. We're having a great party. Come on, join the fun because your younger brother has come back." And Jesus tells us that the elder brother refused to go in. Why? Because the older brother said to himself, "My brother doesn't deserve this." And you know what? Older brother, you are right. The younger brother doesn't deserve a party, but who the heck do you think you are that you deserve it? Oh, are you tasting what I'm chewing now? See, this older brother had to realize in his smug self-righteousness that he was as lost and as guilty as his younger brother. And that's always a challenge for the self-righteous to admit. I'm going to ask the band to please come back on up. See, the love that God displays, the welcome that God extends to those who come to him in repentance and in faith, has nothing to do with our deserving it, but it's entirely a matter of God's grace. The waiting, the watching, the running, the hugging, the kissing, the dancing, this love that God displays has nothing to do with you or me deserving it. It has everything to do with God's grace. We've all forfeited this right to enter into his home. Can you see the correlation for each and every one of us in this story of the prodigal son? There was hell to pay for our sins, folks. That's why Jesus died on the cross, for your sin, for my sin. And unless each one of us comes to that cross and admit it, that we are lost and guilty, and believe that on the cross that Jesus was bearing our sins like there never was another person in the world but you. See, dads, your sin, Jesus bore on the cross. And I'm really trying to hit home this fact to the fathers in the room, because if your family is in disarray, fathers, you have to lead the way. You need to repent. You need to admit you've made mistakes. You need to be that one so that you can give that kind of heavenly father love to your kids. And you can't do it unless you humble yourselves, fathers. And of course, this message isn't just for fathers. It's for everyone to realize what Jesus Christ did on the cross is why our Heavenly Father will meet you like that with compassion and throw a party, because he's so excited that you finally got to the point in your life when you realized you messed up and you can't keep living that way. So you believe in your heart. You confess out of your mouth Jesus Christ is Lord and Savior, and that's the way your Heavenly Father will greet you when you confess things. And it doesn't mean that after that point you're never going to sin again. On the contrary, you're going to mess up. That's why you need Jesus in your life as soon as possible. So it'll help you to prevent you from sinning and doing those old habits. Now, we partake in communion here. It's spread around the back. And I encourage you to individually do this, or as a family, or as a couple, to partake. And you go and do this in remembrance of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. It's just another way to worship him, as we do in song and dance, as we do in giving offerings of tithes, as we do in hearing his word. So partake in that if you've received Jesus Christ. Also, the altar team will be up here. They're here to pray with you, to praise with you. Father, we thank you, Lord, for this opportunity. We thank you, Lord, for anointing this band, Father God. We thank you, Lord, for speaking to our hearts, Father. Stirring us, Father God, to not be complacent today. Stirring us, Father, that fathers will rise up to follow you more than they ever have. Thank you, Lord, for this opportunity. We come to you through your Lord and Savior, your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Please come to your feet and continue worshiping us with us.